Notice, notice, notice. Dear viewers, the emergency manager has decided to hire his PR director's close friends to direct and record Flint City Council meetings for $100 per meeting. I was paid less than $4 a meeting or $1 per hour over the last 3 years. The newly hired company has no intention of providing public access with the footage they now record for the emergency manager with your tax dollars. They have said that they will post the meetings to the city's website. Only 30% of Flint's connected. The good news is that the Flint City Council has stepped up and determined that these broadcasts are important enough to, as they say, put their money where their mouth are. Each council person has and will contribute to the broadcasting of these meetings on public access. I commend them for seeing the value of the programming I have provided for years. Notice, notice, notice. Spectacle Productions, aka Paul Herring, is no longer in charge of recording the city council meetings. We are currently only provided a feed from the master control room and therefore have no control over audio or video. If you like to express your opinion regarding this, you can call me at 810-239-2901 or the emergency manager via the mayor's office, 810-767-7346, option 6. If you would like to see these meetings continue on Fact 17 and ATT's Uverse, consider a monthly contribution of $5. Online, spectacleproductions.com or by phone 810-239-2901. Thanks for watching, and remember, the best way to keep a politician honest is watch them. Paul H. Herring Sr.
Was placed by this council body, not this particular council body, but that's the previous correct. One. So we've been working with this for quite some time. We currently have more than a half a dozen provisional centers inside the city of Flint. We have new ones opening probably every week now with no governance put in place, and we need to take action to move, to put some regulatory action in place for these new centers that's trying to open in our community right now. So I'm ready to vote on this today. I think we've did all the tweaking that's necessary. It is a living document. Ordinances can be amended, can be revised, and it can be tweaked further through the same process. So, but we need to put something in place. We've been doing this, dealing with this for about 3.5 years. Councilwoman Poplar, Nolden, Freeman, and Kincaid, and myself were here. So we've been dealing with this for quite some time. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilperson Gallen. Councilperson Van Buren, do you have anything?
What I want to say is that I appreciate a lot of the comments that were made. I feel like it's like half is supporting this and about half is not. What I was picking up, though, is we realized that we do need to have some type of enforcement, some type of policies, so we can move forward. Like Councilman Neely says, this is something that's been going on for several years. This is my first year on the council, but I believe that we need to rely on those that have been working on this for years, trying to get some type of direction so we can start. And like they say, you know, changes will happen. I mean, whatever we put in place today or whatever we put in yesterday, we're making changes even now on a number of ordinances and so forth. So it doesn't mean it's etched in stone, but it's something for us to start at. And because this is new to this area, you know, how do we know where we can start at if we don't have something already in place? So I understand some of the questions. You know, like I said, some of this is new to me, as to saying about the provisioning centers versus growth centers and cultivation centers. That would be nice to have those specifically spelled out a little bit more. I think it would help to understand where everybody stands at, depending on what they're doing, or even as to caregivers versus residential areas and commercial. You know, I wish that was spelled out a little bit more also, and maybe that's something we can look at. So at this point, I believe we need to do something And I don't want us to be going on this for another 3 years. So I'm, I guess, looking at what else needs to be said and how we come through this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pete, do you want to?
Mr. Chairman, I'm wondering what you got to say before we get to the city attorney. Have you given up your right to say something? We just left out a committee where I thought I had an understanding, and it sounds like that was some mess.
Eric, I respond last after everybody, including the attorney.
Okay, well, I like to respond after the attorney, if I may.
You're not going to respond after the attorney.
I'm not?
No.
Okay, when...
You can respond at the end of the meeting.
Okay, when we get ready to make a motion, then I'll respond. So you get to hear the attorney, then you get to do different from us. Let's keep playing these games. Okay, I'm going to go along with it, but believe me, you ain't no different than us. I asked you to hear from the attorney to be able to properly respond. I was in committee meeting.
I'm not going to respond.
Well, you don't have to. Okay. So then after the city attorney, we carry on with the meeting.
Pete, do you have any response to the questions?
The only question that I recall directed to me was a question about a perceived conflict between the zoning amendment and the proposed provisioning center ordinance. And I don't read the ordinance that way. I don't see a conflict. I believe the speaker indicated that three or more individuals would be individually provisioning centers, but provisioning center is defined as a building or a structure. It's not an individual, even if they each hold state corporate license. They're not individually provisioning centers. It's the building. It's a physical space. And if 25% or more of that is used for cultivation, then it would be a provisioning center. But so there's really no conflict between the zoning regulation and the ordinance. And as Councilman Kincaid said, the language of provisioning center was used because of pending state legislation so that our local ordinance would mirror what we anticipate the state to adopt in terms of regulation of provisioning centers, or what we had previously been calling dispensaries. Ultimately, we want the language in our local ordinance to mirror what the state is using.
Okay. Thank you. All right, moving on. There are no additional petitions or unofficial communications. There are no additional communications from city officials. This is a time for council committee reports, and I will call on you, and if you have a report, I would ask for you to give it. Councilperson Van Buren on public safety.
Yeah, so public safety committee met September the 18th, and Chief Cox and Lieutenant Clapper met with us to give us their update that they have currently 70 firefighters on staff. They are short of 9 firefighters, but they are taking applications for the positions. They've taken over like 200 some applications, and now they will be going through some agility testing, and he's looking at to hire at least 5 by the middle of October. Also, there will October is Fire Prevention Month. On October the 11th will be an open house at all the fire stations, and that's a Saturday. They'll have activities for the family, for the children, and also they'll be giving out free smoke detectors for residents of the city of Flint. The police department, we had Captain Bernie reporting that the current staffing is 108 sworn officers. He gave us a review of the crime stats, which is January through September the 14th, saying that we have a total reduction of all Part 1 crimes by about 13%. Also, Operation Fresh Start had their second...
It's up to the job. I think we're going to have great things coming to Flint. And I want to congratulate all of you, because I cannot navigate without God. I will not make a move without God. I know you're supposed to separate state and church, but I wasn't born that way. I was born to believe in God, and I believe in all the things that I was taught when I was a child. And I want to let you know, someone mentioned racism. Racism comes from the heart. Racism is taught. But I wasn't taught racism in my family. My great-grandmother was a Blackfoot tribe. They were an aggressive tribe, and they moved on to Canada. My other great-grandparents was Colonel McAllister and Colonel McMillan. So what I'm trying to say to you, I do not believe in racism. But I'm going to cut to the chase. One of my friends sold her house in Flint and moved to Grand Blanc. It is more expensive to live in the city of Flint than it is Grand Blanc, Clio, Ohio, Flushing, and other surrounding little suburban areas. So what I'm thinking, since I believe in God and I'm not going to separate state from church, I'm believing if I don't get a refund from the city of Flint from my water bill, I will be leaving. The only thing that's keeping me here in Flint is my parish. And I'll let you know, it's a lot of good people, prominent people, that have left the city of Flint and enjoying their lives and writing books. But water, water everywhere, and not a drop to drink. I learned that when I was a very little girl. What I'm saying to you, this council, work together. You must never be above the people you serve. I just don't believe in racism because whatever make up your background, whatever is in your genes, that's what you are. You are, each and every one of you are special because God made you that way. And if he called you for this job, you must do it to the best of your ability. And first of all, you must implement checks and balances.
Amen.
Balances and checks.
Amen.
Whatever goes on in this city must be checked. It must be a balance.
Amen.
We cannot afford to let anything go by anymore. We cannot let anyone take anything else from us without fighting for it. And I'm going to sit down because I know it's very late. But I'd like to say this to any felon. I believe in second chances. I believe in third chances. This felon wasn't made for everybody, but it was made for you, you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and me. So what we have to do in the future is find out how we can erase these felons without paying an astronomical amount of money. And I want you to work on, I've paid since January, over $2,000 on my water bill. And I want you to work on getting me a refund because it's not in my power to tell you I'm not using that much water. One bill was $411.06. The other bill was, the next bill in the next month was $66. I don't know what your calculations is. I can't count that very well, but I know I'm not using that much water.
Carolyn, will you please sum up?
Okay. I want to let you know I believe in second chances than third chances. So whatever God tells you to do, you're going to have to do it sooner or later. But I would like to say this to Mrs. Jackie Popular, Councilperson Jackie Popular. I was at McDonald's to a party she had for children. For some reason, she gave me a picture of two children that looked like me. So she is in the city doing work. And I suggest that each one of you do work in your community. And I'm going to say this about Mr. Mays. He might not be sitting frozen, but he has the knowledge. And I knew someday God would give him his chance. But I want him to conduct himself in the manner in which God would be pleased. And I thank you very much, and I congratulate your new people, and you have my respect. Thank you.
Thank you, Carolyn.
Mr. President.
Yeah, Mr. Mays.
Ms. Shannon, I always appreciate you, and you always treat council and people up here. You're famous in my mind for calling anybody and every person honorable. I heard your cry about the water rates. You are in the 7th Ward, but you've always supported me, and even to the point where I know how much and the things that you've done. So water bills and $2,000 in a certain amount of time, I had a couple of them during the election, and I knew of one that we dealt with that went from 400, we got it down to 179. And it was some ways that it was done. Mr. Neely, in my mind, was the first pioneer in the water thing, and it tripped me out because when I went to help this person who called me, they had your blue card, Councilman Neely, in the city system and pulled it out and showed. So between Councilwoman Galloway, who is your official person, the knowledge Councilman Neely has helped bestow on me, and as a friend, I believe we need to review your bills and or your 6-month history, but I won't do it formally, but I can assure you that if it's something we can look at that we have knowledge about, because I've had my wad off. And so believe me, I ain't a big shot. I'm going to look out for the least of them because I know it's the right thing to do. We hear your cry. We'll talk to you privately. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker, Madam Clerk.
Our last speaker is Mr. Paul Herring. Mr. Herring.
Good evening, Paul.
Good evening, Council. You know, I usually end with this, but I want to start with this because I've got some things I need to say.
Amen.
It's my favorite quote. It's Booker T. Washington, and he says, "In all things purely social, we can be as separate as the fingers. Yet we have to be one like the hand in all things beneficial to our mutual progress."
Amen.
Okay? And when we talk about jobs, we're talking about our mutual progress. When we're talking about education, we're talking about our mutual progress. When we're talking about working together as a cohesive body, as a community, as politicians, we're talking about things that are beneficial to our mutual progress. Donna Popular got up here and talked about the Flint Journal, and she talked about the Flint Journal like a dog, and we all need to do that. It is deplorable what they have done to this community and that we've let them do that. We need to throw Channel 12, Channel 25, and Channel 5 under the bus as well. You see, I have a unique perspective here. For the last 12 years, I've been presenting the city council meetings to the citizens of Flint unedited, uncut, so that they can see what's going on here even if they can't get down here. It's a service that I provided at my own expense and at yours at some times. You know, Brother Mays, you're throwing out the motions and those referrals. Why don't you make a referral to Brother Early to reinstate my contracts? Okay? To make it possible for me to cover these meetings and more. All right? I'd love to hear that. Okay? We need to take control of our image. We cannot allow the Channel 12s and the Channel 5s to dictate who we are. And the young man that came from the union and asked you to stop talking to the TV stations, could you imagine how powerful that would be? Could you imagine how powerful it would be if 10 or 20 people called SCAF and said, don't let me see another commercial on the news? You know how powerful it would be if 20 or 30 people called Patsy Lou and said, you better not put another commercial on the news or we're not coming to buy cars from you? Maybe that's a little extreme. Maybe that's the second step. Maybe the first step is calling over and talking to the station manager.
Amen.
And threatening it.
Amen.
Maybe that's the first step. Maybe the first step is sitting down with the editor at the Flint Journal and saying no more.
Amen.
No more. And holding them to it. We're 100,000 strong. Even if we have 10,000 criminals in the city of Flint, 10,000 of us are doing wrong, there's still 999,000 of us that aren't. Why are we giving them the power? Why is that what we talk about at the water cooler? Why is that the first thing you bring up when you go have dinner? There's Boy Scouts, there's Girl Scouts, there's senior citizens. There's enough good going on in this community that we could fill volumes. There's 990,000 of us that are making stories every day, that are paying our mortgages, that are paying our water bills. We're sending our kids to school, and we're taking care of our pieces of property here in the city of Flint. Let's credit them. Let's applaud them. Let's get out of being so negative in this city. It's ungodly. It's unbelievable that as many churches as we got in this city and as many people claim to be God's brother, that we have this kind of problems. It's amazing. Now, I said that to say this, believe it or not. We're getting ready for this year's Juneteenth celebration. Not Juneteenth, but the Kwanzaa celebration. We're gonna be hosting it over at Mirren Hall. And we're always looking for organizations, individuals, and groups to sponsor or host an evening. If it's something that sits on your heart, if it's something that you feel is beneficial to folks that look like me, and folks that look like you, and folks that don't look like either of us.
Amen.
We need you to support it. It's a chance to bring people together. I've always condoned any excuse to bring a group of folks together to talk about positive things.
Amen.
You know, it's a time to reflect and rejoice. We want to reflect about where we've been, but we want to rejoice about where we're going. So I'm always looking for support. That said, got another issue. These city council meetings are only broadcast on Channel 17. They're only on Channel 17. And that means only Comcast subscribers get to see this.
Wow.
And in wrapping up, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to generate some funds. I'm trying to generate some money so that I can put these council meetings on late night TV on the networks. So the people who don't have Comcast can see it. The people who have the AT&Ts and the Dish Network can participate in city government by being able to view these meetings in their homes.
Amen.
If you guys are interested in helping me do that, please feel free to give me a call at 259-9789, and let's make things better. Remember, in all things purely social, we can be as separate as the fingers, but we need to be one like the hand in all things beneficial to our mutual progress.
Thank you, Paul. Okay,
Mr. President,
I'm sorry.
I'll make this fairly quickly. I would like to send a referral down to Darner Early, the emergency manager, to ask them to reinstate the contract and or compensation for Mr. Heron, to make sure these broadcasts continue, because this is a vital instrument to get to the people who cannot make it out to the council meetings to actually see city government at work. So I would like that referral to be sent. Thank you.
Support that.
Yeah, I recognize that referral. And, you know, for members of the public, council members, when the Channel 17 was taken away, we coalesced and collected money so that we could pay Mr. Herring so that he could do these broadcasts, because we felt that it was very important for the community. So I will personally, Councilman Nolan and I will personally talk to Mr. Early about continuing these programs, because I do believe it's important for the community.
Mr. President, when Mr. Herring spoke, he mentioned Ms. Donna Poplar, and so that was the last speaker, correct?
Mr. Herring is the last speaker.
That was the last speaker, so I want to take this time to piggyback on what him and Ms. Poplar said. I asked Ms. Poplar to write down and send me up some of the things that she said as an action step as it relates to the journal, because remember, Ms. Poplar didn't have to say it. I was appalled when I seen, and nobody else might have been appalled, but I was appalled when I seen a mixed Councilwoman Poplar and Councilwoman Galloway with the story with Mr. Davis and I. That was just me. And so then I got a call from Marjorie Raymer, and she apologized this morning. And I wanted to know exactly what do you interpret that you're apologizing for? And she kind of indicated in her private conversation, and I said to her, that God is good. And I said to her and recommended that she read Proverbs, the 3rd chapter, the 5th and 6th verse. But nonetheless, something or somebody made them call and apologize. And I like Dominique, and I told Dominique the Lord move in mysterious ways, that I'm glad that that stuff didn't hit 3 days earlier, because it could have affected the outcome. Even though it's been documented, I'm still saying I got 2 felonies. It still ain't tight yet, but they'll get to it. And then I'll tell you what happened in each one of them. And I'm cool with it, because, see, I will show you and warn that sometimes you can be a convicted felon, but you don't really, ain't really wrong. And then I'll show you when the gun charges, the law changed, where right now in 2012, it wouldn't affect me, because in 87, you couldn't get a permit to carry. But when you try to kill me, I'm going to carry. And if you threaten me now and I ain't supposed to have a gun, I'm going to still have one, because I'm a felon. It's just some stuff that I know to survive. And you'll see that I prosecuted the people who was threatening me in a jury trial, and me and my brother convicted them, and they kept coming. But my point is this. I've got to take action, and we've got the right to inquire. And the public got the right to know. So, Ms. Poplar, I thank you on point. This is what my brain says. Will Marjorie Raymer come before us? I would like a communication sent to see if Marjorie Raymer and or anybody from the journal want to speak to us in a public setting. That'll be 1 request and 1 referral. I would also say that if they don't want to come to us, that we would like a written apology, because I got one on the phone for whatever it was for. I would also say that at this point, once they give us a written, this is the 3rd thing, and I might have jumbled them up together, but give us, if they choose, they don't have to, a written explanation of what their intent was, or what they was thinking, or, you know, what is they apologizing for if they didn't do wrong. Now, after we get that done, I want to say to the public that I suggested something once I seen that about the Grand Blanc Council. And some people tell me that it's on the, you know, it's on there now where when you go to M Live, you can read a story that's similar to the Grand Blanc ones about us being a historic black council and that the women had made history. So I think it's on there. Is there something on there now like that, Dominique? You nodding your head in the affirmative. And I think that's a great type of story. That's the story that I think should have came out first. I think the women should have been separated. And I'm a person of first, second, and third chances. So Ms. Poplar, I'm gonna keep these action steps and we gonna take it in an escalating fashion and see if they will come forward, because it's not just a private apology or explanation to us. It was a public story. So let's see if we can gradually get some action and communication, and if we can't, then we're going to exercise some additional steps, because first, let's see who's willing to communicate publicly rather than all these little private apologies and stuff. So if it's understood that referral is so made, and you give it to me a week or two or three or so, and I'll talk to you if you choose to talk to me. But it's a lot of people, including the NAACP, who made calls. And I heard you on the radio, and I hear you now. And if we are people of second and third chances, then let's see if we can work together. Let's see what they do, and let's see if we can move this community journalistically forward and make our image look like what it should be.
Thank you, Eric. What I think I'm hearing you, and correct me if I'm wrong, you'd like to send a letter to Marjorie, the publisher and the editor, and ask them to come to a council meeting and ask them in the letter to report to us what their intent was for the article and the timing of the article and what precipitated it at that time. That's what I think I'm hearing you say.
Yeah, if they choose to. And then also I want to ask them in the letter if they will tell me what they was apologizing for. Not necessarily me, but I got a call about an apology, and I've never had a newspaper apologize to me in my life. So that confirms that something in their journalistic realm they see they done wrong, and I'm not sure what it is, and I don't want to put words in their mouth.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
I can swear to God, I got a call for some type of an apology, and I want that cleared up in the letter. But if they choose not to put that in the letter, however they choose to do it, I just want some communications to see if we can get some movement, not privately, but publicly, because it was a public article and it affected the images of us, more so Ms. Galloway and Ms. Poplar, and if I'm okay to say it, then me and Mr. Davis.
Yes, sir.
I just think it was a separate. So I just want to see if we can start some movement publicly with those people in front of this council and in front of the public. And I think if it happens, it'll be good for everybody. But let's see if it'll happen. And however you word that, I know you're more confused than if I had kept my mouth shut. But you are the president. Those are the communications, and if you want me to review it once it's wrote, or if it's satisfactory to Ms. Poplar, Ms. Galloway, or even Ms. Donna Poplar, I'm sure we can get it together.
Well, Mr. Mays, I just want to communicate this to you and my other colleagues, that any communications that are sent out by me as a request by a council person, it's never sent before that council person reviews it and then okays it, okay? Just so that you know, I don't put a letter together and send it and give you a copy of it.
I worked with the clerk and the staff to put a letter together as a draft, give that to the person or persons that are requesting this, and then ask them if they want to make any changes or whatever, and then we put it in a final form and then send it.
Ms. Donna Popple, is that okay for a start? You can nod your head or whatever. May I, please?
Yes.
Okay, so understanding that, I will say if we can start and see if we can get some public communication, then we might can eventually get to where she's saying. I don't know if I'll get that extreme, don't get me wrong, but I'll just start with trying to get them here publicly.
We'll have a draft to do that, okay?
Thank you, President Kincaid.
Okay. That completes our speakers for this evening. I'm sorry, Jackie.
That's okay. I just got one thing to say about this Flint Journal article. I've been hanging around the city of Flint, and I know that, and I truly believe, that somebody much, much bigger than Marjorie Raymer instigated that article in that newspaper. I may be wrong, but I do believe that somebody threw Marjorie up under the bus, and I don't believe we'll ever get to the true story, because all of us know that there's always been a family of Mr. Biggs in this city, and that's how come our city hasn't prospered the way it should be. And each and every one of you guys know that. If you look around the city, just look around the city, every city, Lansing, Ann Arbor, they all have tall buildings. The city of Flint only has one tall building, because the other one getting ready to fall. So somebody in this city had Marjorie Raymer to instigate that story. And I bet you 10 to 1, we'll never know. We'll never know. Even though Marjorie was thrown up under that bus, she's still not going to say where she got those orders from. And those orders came from somebody that does not want this council to come out from under a state takeover. Mr. Ballinger said that himself in his little article that he wrote, and he don't know nothing about me, and he really don't know nothing about anybody on this council, because I don't think he's been in our presence, nor has he went into our past to see what we have done in this city. So somebody does not want us to be out from up under a state takeover. And this is just the beginning. Just watch it and see. And when it happens, when you find out the little tidbits, you say, yeah, she was right. But it's bigger than Marjorie Raymer. It's much bigger.
Mr. President, can I say something real quick, Mr. President?
Thank you, Jack.
Mr. President, can I say something?
I realize that I'm out of order.
Yeah, you're out of order right now, okay?
But those statements that were written about women.
Excuse me.
I would suggest that you file a federal civil rights complaint, not with the state, but with the federal government, and you will know who was the culprit of that.
I'd like to say something. Ms. Poplar, I applaud you for that. Thank you very much for that initiative. On my behalf, I feel that it was unfair to me and the family that was involved in my situation. And I've spoke to some of the family members in my situation, and we got a great understanding, and we had a good rapport at the end. But first more, I would like to apologize, because I'm going to show somebody that I'm a bigger man than what somebody think that I am. I'm going to apologize to the young man I'm looking at right now that was highly emotional about that situation. If I can go back at the age of 17, I would think of things a little differently. But my mother was involved in that. And I know you love your mother. Well, it was the premise of my mother. And I know you love your mother. But I want you to know, any emotions that you felt out of that, any pain you may have felt out of that, I'm going to extend my apology to you, because I have friends that I love too. But at this particular time, I want you to know that that situation that occurred was attributed to who I am today. And just by the grace of God, we don't know what God has in store for us. But whatever he has in store for us, we move towards that purpose. And it's a revelation that we have to embrace. And today is a revelation. So I want to extend my apology to the pain that you may have suffered behind your friend. Because if I had a friend that I do have and I love dearly, I would feel your pain too. So that's just something I want to say. And God bless all of y'all.
Thank you, Councilman Davis. Anyone else? That concludes our speakers for this evening. We have no resolutions tonight. On our agenda, there are two ordinances for second reading. They deal with, I just want to explain them real quick. We've had a public hearing on them. They deal with the zoning of the regulations for medical marijuana dispensary facilities, and they deal with the licensing of those facilities. Conversations with the city attorney's office, they have asked that we postpone these to the first meeting in January. There are some things that are going on not only locally but at the state level, and the attorney's office would like them done till January. Is that correct?
I'd like to make a motion to postpone.
That's correct.
Okay, there's a motion to postpone. Is there support?
Support.
It's been moved and supported. Discussion? Roll, Madam Clerk.
See, Mr. Freeman is gone.
Yeah, Mr. Freeman left.
Okay.
I support it.
Mr. Davis?
Yes, yeah, support.
Mr. Neely?
Yes, yes, yes.
Mr. Neely?
Yes, for postponement.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes, for postponement.
Ms. Van Buren?
Yes.
Mr. Kincaid?
Yes.
Mr. Mays?
Yes, for postponement.
Ms. Poplar?
Yes.
Mr. Nolden?
Yes.
The vote is 8 yes, 0 no to postpone 130343.2 and 130344.4.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Are there any council persons wishing to speak at this time? I'm going to start on this side and then I'll move around. Councilman Nolden? I've seen your hand first, but Mr. Mays?
I'll defer to you.
Mr. President, I heard in one instance that you said you and Councilman Nolden would inquire to Mr. Early about something, and I got a burning desire for another inquiry. I don't know if I got to put it on record as a formal referral, but to me, if we're in a state of emergency, and if we're not denied the right to meet, the sooner we can get things in order and restore this democracy, the better. In other words, one meeting a month, the city ain't getting their money worth out of me, and y'all neither. This is a council meeting that don't just meet out here for show, but to me, the work was always done back in the committee room. And committee meetings has gone away. Now, under your leadership and under us working together, I have a burning desire to start committee meetings back up. Now, I know this is a part-time job, and I know other people got jobs, and I'm retired. I was DMUAW. And I know that if you set the committees up right, and if part of us is here and part of us ain't because of jobs, I understand that. I want people to be able to support their families. They've been elected, and I want them to be good council people. So to make a long request short, what I'm asking is that we go to work for the people And the more work we do, the sooner we can restore democracy and a regular government. It just behooves me that it ain't nothing that we can do. I believe it is stuff we can do, and I believe we should do it in our committee structures with regular committee meetings, and I want to know if the emergency manager objects to that. We're not getting paid too much or nothing anyway, so I want to see which council people are like me and have the desire to go to work. See, I don't believe in sitting back and letting them figure it out. I believe some of us are smarter than them, and we can get it figured out quicker and faster, so let's give it a try. I'm suggesting that we institute the committee meetings. In that committee meeting, the vice chair chairs the meetings. Oh, that's special affairs, excuse me. But I even want special affairs prior to these meetings, but you say ain't nothing on the agenda. So keep in mind what I'm getting at. On the committee meetings, whether they put something on the agenda or not, it's certain committee work we could do. For example, if we postpone the second reading on the medical marijuana, if we ain't got a regular committee meeting scheduled, and if you don't see one before we leave here now, I would wonder if I, according to the charter that's still in place, made a motion for a special council meeting, would this council believe that they could do it? Well, I know I could do it with two or more council people. Mr. President, when is the next council meeting scheduled?
December the 16th at 5:30.
December the 16th at 5:30. Is that on a Monday?
Yes.
Nothing in between?
No.
Do you think that's satisfactory?
No, but I also know that the only reason we're meeting here today is because the emergency manager allows us. When the emergency manager originally took over from the city of Flint, he terminated all council meetings and all committee meetings.
You're talking about Mike Brown or early?
I'm talking about Mike Brown.
Okay, and we then, got a new one. I want to test him.
Well, and we've had, and just so that you know, to my colleagues, we've had this discussion with him. And what I think is very important, as you meet with him in the next 2 weeks, or this week and next week, because I heard him say today that he wanted to reach out to all council members and meet with them, I would hope that each individual council member would express that to him, because it really is his decision.
Remember, I don't believe in emergency managers, but maybe y'all do. That's why I want to use you to talk to him, because that's what y'all, I mean, you believe in dealing with him a certain way. That's why I protested and got up when he spoke. But I did that, but I mean, I'll talk to him myself about it. But if you just told me you believe that that ain't enough meeting, let me ask you another question. Do it cost the city when we meet in a room, or is it free?
There's no cost.
So why should he object to us meeting? Now, I want to find out if he object to us meeting, and if I have to find out by getting one colleague and invoking the charter, because two or more council people can call a meeting with 24-hour notice, but I'm just want to see what you come back and tell me. Are you opposed to checking to see if we can get our meetings?
No, I've personally talked to him about it. Councilman Nolden, if you were in the meeting.
If I could, Councilman Mays, we've had that conversation with him prior to the election, and he did say that he was open for us to have some additional meetings.
Okay, well, can I say this? Next Monday at 5:30, I want to get a notice. I want to make a motion that this council meet, and that means you have, under the charter, two or more council members can do it. It don't say if it's in writing, but it say you have to have two or more, and it says you have to get a public notice. And I know that Ms. Brown does her job on notices. And so I'm going to do it in the form of a motion, and let's see what happens with the council, and then let's see what happens with the emergency manager. I'd like to move for a special council meeting next Monday at 5:30, and that the agenda would be general city business as it relates to business that need to be taken care of. If they want to add something on the agenda, that's fine. Now, in discussion, if you believe that's not right, if it may get a second, but I'm going to aggressively try to do my job, and I can't do it without council meetings. You got to have a quorum. That's the way we operate. So I so move that we have a special meeting next Monday at 5:30.
Mr. President.
Councilman Neely.
If I be so kind to offer this as a recommendation or a suggestion, let's let the new council members that's not as seasoned as yourself to get a time to be acclimated and to move forward with the training process so they can meet department heads and get a feel for the scope of the full responsibilities of council people before we engage in those meetings, so they'll know their role and responsibility a little more. So I think now if we schedule a meeting next week, it'll be a little premature. Let's be fair to our colleagues, and I would just make that as a recommendation going forward so they can get acclimated to the process prior to just having a barrage of meetings. If I could be so kind to make that as a recommendation to you.
Either a motion gonna pass or die for a lack of second, but I'm on record, and I think that we got to do our job and meet. I'm not offended, but I'm going to still be a man of action rather than talk.
Mr. President, if I could, I'd like to make a comment to go along with Mr. Neely. Is I believe for us to be effective, we have to know what the rules are here, the protocol that exists. Because I don't want to, since being new to the group, walk in and then mess things up. I want to know how I can be good at what I'm doing. I want to be effective, and I want to work with what exists and be a part of a partnership that we need to be successful here. So I don't want to disrupt what's already here. I want to be strong, and I want us to be strong together. So, you know, I'm looking forward to the orientation that I heard Inez mention. I'm looking forward to what the emergency manager mentioned earlier about meeting with us. And, you know, please give us some information so we can be strong and in good and be the best that we can in our jobs.
Ms. Van Buren, Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Go ahead.
To Mrs. Van Buren, my intent is to help make us stronger. See, we can get information from the emergency manager. We can get information from individuals individually, because that's what y'all have been doing. Five people at least, because I wasn't included in it. So what I'm getting at is this. I got the same intent you got. But I think the only way we can talk as a group is when we meet. That's what the law say. So regardless of what anybody else got set up for us, it's incumbent upon me, and I don't mind if it die for a lack of a second, but guess what? I know that if they say he's open to us meeting, then it's on us. If he's open to it, he shouldn't be offended. It don't disrupt nothing if we try or attempt to call a meeting. And so, therefore, I make the motion, if that information about open is true, we ain't pissing nobody off. If people want to wait and not talk as a group and do it like y'all been doing it, we'll figure it out. But my motion stands. I'm ready to go to work. If it dies for a lack of a second, I'm not offended. It's just that I'm going to do everything I can to get us meeting, because the more we meet, the sooner we can get the work done. The sooner we get the work done, the sooner we restore democracy, in my opinion.
Thank you. There's a motion that's been moved. Is there support? Mr. Mays, your motion dies for lack of support.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Jackie, do you have anything? Thank you. Councilman Nolan?
Just real things that I wanted to just say. One, there's going to be a major announcement this Wednesday related to the Buick City site coming from the Racer Trust Group. I'm very excited about it. I'm not really at liberty to really go into it, but the Journal actually, somebody leaked information to them. So they've got an article in the paper that you can actually look at today. But it's something that has been in the works for some time and is related to the pipeline. It's related to the pipeline that's coming. And it's a major corporation that's going to have a significant investment, going to build a manufacturing plant at the Buick City site. So this is going to be coming on Wednesday. The other thing that I just wanted to say, this Friday night from 7 to 10 p.m. at Omen Temple on North Saginaw on Gillespie, myself and Juantez is going to have just a short victory celebration. We have food and fun for folks. If you want to stop by just to congratulate us, it'll be from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. at Omen Temple, right on the corner of, it's on the north side for some of y'all that's scared of the north side. But it's going to be around the corner of Gillespie and North Saginaw. I had asked my colleague also, Mr. Mays, but he said he didn't know if he was going to be able to make it or not. But he's welcome to come as well. It's free, open to the public, and we hope you'll come down and just, talk with us, congratulate us, or whatever you might want to do. Thank you.
Mr. President, could I ask you a question real quick, through you to Councilman Nolan? You stated that that announcement would be made. I know what it is, and maybe I leaked it because I didn't know I was to be quiet, but maybe I didn't. But my question relevant to that, do we have representative that's already scheduled to be at that announcement? And I know you are vice president and Mr. Yes. Kincaid is the president, but I know Mr. Neely sits on that Karagandy board. And I'm very curious to see if these jobs and things that announced, if this is true, whatever it is, he say we can read about it. I know what it is. But I want to know that we're going to be represented at that announcement.
I would definitely be there. I've had my invitation for about 2 weeks.
Okay.
I have not received any communications as it relates to any particular announcement or date as of yet.
Mr. President, in light of that, could I make a referral to Jeff Wright that he contact Mr. Neely in the next 24 hours relevant to that?
I think, Mr. Mays, that the invitation come from the Genesee Regional Chamber, not from Jeff Wright's office.
Well, then I could amend that and hope that this body...
What I know of the details of the announcement, it's this Wednesday at 2 o'clock.
Yeah, but I want this man and others and you, and have you got a formal invitation that you've had for 2 weeks, Mr. President? Mr. Nolan help with what I'm trying to get to?
Actually, it came to each one of us in our council email. If you looked at your council email about 2 weeks ago, every council member was invited come to it.
Would the new council people then be invited? I mean,
I'm not sure.
Can we clear that up, if Mr. President, if you can handle that, or Mr. Nolan can handle it informally?
All council members will be welcome to the announcement.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Davis, Councilman Davis, Councilman Neely.
Yes, just a quick announcement. Just to clear up some misinformation as it relates to current legislation that I was preparing about dogs in our community. The ordinance is pretty much what I'm working on is geared toward poor dog owners of a vicious breed dog. And we talked about the pit bull breed dog in this piece of legislation. I know Council President Kincaid has also spoke to legal as it relates to getting me some support and some help on that. And also, I want to send a referral to legal and Peter. Is Peter still over there? I can't see him. Oh, yeah, Peter, if as much in the past, I know your office is really busy with all the other things, but We need to move forward, and I need some help from your department as we move forward with some maybe legislation to help enforce dog owners inside the city of Flint that owns these vicious breed dogs to comply with the rules and regulations. If I can get just some support, you know, from your office, that's going to be required. I know Scott has talked to you about it in the past. No. If we can get that done, because this is a photo of a 12-year-old girl that was attacked here in the city of Flint. They had to undergo some significant undergo stitches and different things of that nature. Dog animal control is currently run by the county. Animal control was notified of the situation. They went to the site. They quarantined the dog right where the dog resides for 10 days. After the 10-day period elapsed, the dog still resides two doors away from where this young girl was attacked in the public right-of-way. She was playing outside. The dog came out, attacked her. The owner had to come out and pry the dog away from her. The family had to forego a lot of regular everyday expenses because they had to pay for the stitches and probably some consultation or some counseling for this young girl. They could not go after the owners civilly because the owner was a renter and they did not have renter's insurance. And so with that, you know, currently the county operates our animal control inside the city of Flint. But I think we need to beef this up because some of these dogs, and we've all seen them, not the majority, but some of these dogs are vicious breed dogs, and they can inflict great bodily harm upon the public if they're not controlled by their owners. So what I'm proposing is put a piece of legislation together to make dog owners accountable for their animals. And if their animals attack people to inflict harm, I would like to go after them criminally. And so with that, I would like to send a referral to legal, and as soon as we can, we start working on drafts of this, and I'm working with a lot of people and working on that.
Yeah. I recognize that.
Just one question through you, Mr. President, to Neely, Councilman Neely. Are you just singling out pit bulls?
No, what I was saying, Councilman Nolan, I said dog owners.
Because you know that has been the, the general perception that a lot of people in the community have, that you're singling out pit bulls, and you know, with me being a 35 year plus owner of pit bulls that have grown up in my house in the neighborhood or whatever, I was just hoping that we weren't just singling out one particular breed, because you know any dog can be vicious if you don't have the proper training. So you know that was just my concern. But okay, thank you.
Right, but just I'm gonna respond to that because that is some of the miscommunications and
thank you.
Some of these dog owners that own pit bull dogs, and it will be somewhat breed specific. I'm not really worried about a Chihuahua or a Schnauzer killing me. They don't have the propensity nor the capability to do so. But I am afraid of a pit bulldog. But I'm going after the owners and irresponsible owners of these dogs. And there are 17 other local units of government inside of the state of Michigan that also have breed-specific legislation against pit bull animals. Some communities ban them altogether. You cannot own them. Other communities have designate them as dangerous and vicious animals. So this is not anything groundbreaking as it relates to talking about pit bulls, but it is groundbreaking as we talk about ownership of these animals. Most people that engage in nefarious activity, dog fighting, illegal activity to use these dogs to protect their product or whatever, we're trying to make sure this community is safe. This young girl is so traumatized that she's afraid to leave her home. We have no laws currently on our books to beef it up. So when and some dog owners has even related me going after a breed-specific legislation, talked about, they even equated it to racial relations, black and white, related it to gay marriages. And anytime those individuals are of a mindset they can equate a canine to human issues, race relations, sexual orientations, I think they're a little skewed, but we will be working with all parties of like thinking to make sure that owners are responsible. I'm going to repeat it one more time, Councilman Nolden. Owners are responsible for their animals. And if those animals can inflict great bodily harm upon the public, especially children, seniors, I would love to see people walking through their community exercising, but they can't because they're afraid of loose canines. And so I'm not gonna bend or bow to the will of individuals that will equate human issues, reality issues, when we have these type of attacks that's happening on children in our community. And so I'm gonna try to draft a good piece of legislation that speaks to that. I'm gonna need you, Peter, on this as much as possible to draft something that's equitable, because we don't wanna penalize good owners, but we definitely wanna penalize bad owners. I'm gonna need my colleagues' support on this as well. Thank you.
Mr. President, can I say something real quick? Mr. Nilly, what is your remedy or resolution towards stray dogs? Because there's a lot of stray pet bulls and vicious dogs just roaming around. Would that be implemented into that as well? I mean, what can we do? Because I see stray dogs running around on a consistent basis, and you know, a dog is a dog. You know, you never know if it's vicious or not. So what do we do about that?
With stray dogs, we have legislation to speak to stray dogs. They're going to be picked up and quarantined and either euthanized or adopted out by animal control, which is ran by the county. This legislation, once again, is talking about dog owners. A stray dog does not have an owner.
That's right, but it's not being enforced because there are a lot of stray dogs. So.
Absolutely. Okay. And that's animal control that's ran by the county.
Okay.
And so if we need to get our county counterparts over here, because we do pay taxes to the county for this type of enforcement, stray dogs have no owners. But if but stray dogs come from somewhere. But if we registered those dogs, we would know if that dog was truly a stray dog or had a person who claimed to be an owner of that dog to let it go and roam our streets. So this is not what I consider a debatable issue. It's like we have a problem and we just got to figure out a good remedy to it. I'm not going to be an advocate to try to say that I'm going to attack all pit bull dogs or dog owners or look at this, but we need to make sure that the city of Flint, and this is the governance we have in the city of Flint, if the county's not doing their job, we still have an obligation to the residents inside the city of Flint. And I'm just trying to fulfill that obligation, making sure that people and children can play in parks, people can walk in parks, people can walk in their neighborhoods without fear of a dog coming to attack them. And when we talk about the humane situation, loving pit bulls, we've had at least 13 police officers had to put down 13 canines this summer with a shotgun because that's what it requires. And that's inhumane when you talk about putting down a canine. They have to shoot these dogs. And so we need to figure out a solution. I'm not going to say it's going to be easy, but our job is somewhat difficult. And I'm asking for all input to come together to figure out a way that we can have our streets safer for our families. Thank you.
Mr. President, and that's why I talked about the committee meetings. That would normally be done in legislative committee. And so I don't want to be out here on the floor doing ordinances. So that's exactly why I asked if Mr. Nilly needs our support and if I need to look at it to see if I support it, that tells me for sure that I'm right. Do we have the authority? I know I got it because I'll draft it up and do it, and if it go through, it don't. But so that part of our function has not been taken away. We still drafting legislation and ordinances. Mr. Nilly, what's the timetable? I mean, you referred it to who? The city attorney's office? What happened to legislative committee? Do you see why I'm inquiring? Because this is a different way of doing ordinances than I know. How do we do that? What's going on? What is y'all doing? What's the procedure? Did you refer it to legislative? Is that gone?
Well, I do have confidence in the legal department because we have worked in partnership with the legal department on many different occasions to help create legislation and quality of life type of rules for our community. I do have full confidence that Peter has heard, he has agreed, he will assign one of the people in the legal department to assist me through this, and we will do our investigation and our research and our consultation with other canine organizations and colleagues in order to move this forward. So I'm confident the timeline will be perfected to get a good piece of legislation through. We're not gonna rush anything, but we do wanna continue to move forward and have forward progress on this. So I'm confident in the legal department. I'm confident in the process that we currently have. But we will move forward on this. And I appreciate you saying that we need different committees to meet on this. But as it relates to this particular project, I'm confident that we will move forward from this point.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, through you to Councilman Neely, I'll talk to you privately and I'll talk to both of y'all, but if we drafting legislation and bypassing our own legislative committee, if that's the procedure, that's what I'm getting at. I like it the old way, but if this is the new way we legislatures work, I disagree with it, but I hear it and I'll see if I'm right or wrong, but that's not how we've done business in the past. But I can maybe support it, Mr. Neely, but I just want to see how we draft in legislation. That's one of our major functions, and I think we should do it together. I'll wait to see. God bless.
Thank you. Councilwoman Galloway, do you have anything? Councilwoman?
No, I don't.
Okay, I just want to make an announcement. Our next City Council meeting will be on December the 16th at 5:30 p.m. here in the Council Chambers. I just want to thank everyone for being here tonight. I want to thank my colleagues, and again, I commit and will demonstrate working with each and every one of you. Thank you very much.